familiar passage. Look down at verse number 5. The Bible says, "And God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." Let me stop and say, God still sees the wickedness of man, and it still is great in the earth. Verse number 6, "And it repented the Lord that he made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I've created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and the creeping thing and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them." Verse number 11, "The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence." Verse 12, "And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth." Lord, I want to thank you for this day. God, thank you for your grace, your love, your mercy. Thank you for allowing us to be in this place. Thank you for this pastor, this man of God who stands here faithfully. God, each member that's here as the family, the body of Christ. And God, I thank you for it. God, I pray that you'd have your way in this service. Thank you for what our ears have already heard, our hearts have felt. But God, it's time for the preaching, and I'd ask that you touch me. I need a touch of the Holy Ghost. I need the presence of God. And Lord, everything that's said and done, we want to be careful to give you the praise. If there's one lost in our midst, God, I pray that tonight they'd make their way down an old-fashioned altar, have somebody take the Word of God and show them what it means to be saved. Everything that you do through us and for us and in us, we want to be careful to praise you, because it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. You can be seated. If I had not told you to turn to Genesis chapter number 6, and I'd have just started reading, some of you might have thought I was reading out of today's newspaper. What I read to you is current events. The earth is continually evil. Man's thoughts are evil. His heart is desperately wicked. The earth is still filled with violence. The earth is still filled with corruptness. The earth is still filled with sin. We've come full circle from Noah's day to our day. The earth is just as bad now as it was then. But even in the midst of the darkness, even in the midst of the turmoil, even in the midst of the sin and the strife, there still is a verse number 8 in Noah's day, and there still is a verse number 8 in our day. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. I'm glad in the darkest of times, there still is the grace of God. Where sin abound, the Bible said, grace did much more abound. And when there's sin on every hand, when there's sinners everywhere, there still is a grace that saves. There still is room at the cross. There still is a time and a place for somebody to be saved by God's amazing grace. Everybody here, from the youngest to the oldest, knows this story that I read to you. God comes to Noah and says, "Noah, I want you to build an ark. I'm giving man 120 years. I'm tired of the sin. I'm tired of the wickedness. I'm tired of man's continual disobedience to me." And God said, "I'm going to destroy every man, every beast, every creeping thing, every fowl of the air." God says, "I'm just going to wipe everything that has breath off the earth." He comes to Noah in verse number 14 and says, "Make thee an ark." If my North Carolina public school math education is correct, the Bible says in Genesis chapter number 7, I believe it's verse number 11, in Noah's 600th year, the rains came. 600 minus 120, Noah is 480 years old and in a building project. The last verse of chapter number 5 tells us in Noah's 500th year, God gave him Shem, Ham, what some believe to be triplets, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. So Noah has a wife. He doesn't have any kids. And God comes to him and says, "I'm going to make a way out. I'm going to make a way of escape. The only way you're going to miss the judgment, the only way you're going to miss the flood, the only way you're going to miss the 40 days and 40 nights of being rained upon and being judged by the hand of God." God says, "You have to get in the boat." But I'm wondering, what was Noah's greatest motivation for building the ark? What was his greatest purpose? What was his driving force? You say, well, it was because God told him to. Yeah, that's a really good reason to do it, because God tells us to. We as children of God ought to obey our Heavenly Father. We ought to do what God tells us to do. But Noah, just like you and I, had a will. Noah, just like you and I, made a choice. Noah could have said, "No, thank you, God. I'm too busy." Then where would history be? God would have pretty well had to start all over had Noah said no. But I believe when God comes to Noah in verse number 14 of chapter number 5 or chapter number 6 and says, make thee an ark, I believe Noah might have took a peek over his shoulder and saw his little wife standing back there. And every verse in chapter number 5 tells us that so-and-so begat so-and-so, lived so many days, and after he begat so-and-so, he begat sons and daughters, and he lived so many other days, and the total of his life was this many days. And every generation before Noah had begat sons and daughters. His dad, his granddad, his great-granddad had begat sons and daughters. And I'm sure Noah looking at his wife and thinking, you know, if she's not in the boat when the judgment comes, she's going to die just like everybody else. And I'm sure Noah aspired to be a father. I'm sure he wanted to be a father, and I'm sure he said, God has given me 120 years. In 120 years, we're probably going to have some children, and if my children are not in the boat when the judgment falls, they're going to die just like everybody else. Hebrews chapter number 11, verse number 7, I believe gives us Noah's greatest motivation for building the ark. I believe it gives us his driving force. I believe it gives us his purpose for building the ark. The Bible says by faith, verse number 11, or chapter number 11, verse number 7, by faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark, listen to the next six words, to the saving of his house. I believe Noah took a peek over his shoulder and said, you know, I've got to do all I can as a husband to save my house. I believe Noah might have looked through the telescope of time, maybe saw some children that his wife was going to bear to him. And I believe Noah said, I've got, as a husband, as a dad, I've got to do everything in my power to save my house. In an hour when our homes are under such great attack, when marriage, the sanctity of marriage, is under such great attack, I believe we as dads, we as fathers, we as husbands, we need to vow to ourselves and vow to God, I need to do in this time when it's so wicked and vile out there, me as a dad, me as a husband, I need to do everything in my power to save my house.
Yes, sir.
The Bible, Brother Jason, is not clear on how long it actually took Noah to build the ark. It's not clear in that 120 year span, Brother Brian, how long it actually took Noah to build the ark. It might have took him 50 years. It might have took him 75 years. It might have took him the full 120 years. Maybe he was a good carpenter. He might have got it done in 10 years. But the Bible is not clear on how long it actually took. The Bible does tell us that Noah was a preacher of righteousness. So I'm sure Noah would go out and preach. He'd come back and build. He'd go out and preach. He'd come back and build. It could have took him the whole 120 years of preaching a week, working a few days, preaching a week, working a few days. It might have taken him the whole 120 year process to build the boat. I'm sure maybe after 5 years, I don't have a clue how far along the ark is. But somebody might have heard of Noah's message. Somebody might have heard of Noah saying, hey, there's going to be a judgment. There's going to be a flood. Somebody might have come and said, Noah, we just had to see for ourselves what you're doing right here in your front yard. Noah, we just had to come and see what you're going to build. Noah, are you building this so-called ark just to make a name for yourself? Are you just building a boat? And I'm sure Noah would peek over his shoulder, look back at his wife, and he'd say, shake his head. He'd say, no, sir. I'm not just building a boat, but I'm doing all I can, Brother Tony, to save my house. How did Noah save his house? How did Noah save his family? I believe Hebrews chapter number 11, verse number 7 gives us five ways Noah saved his house. The Bible says, number one, I believe Noah saved his house by simply just believing the word of God.
Yes,
you say, how do you know that? The very first two words of Hebrews chapter number 11, verse number 7, by faith.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter number 11, verse number 7, it's the only verse in that chapter that starts off by faith and ends up by faith. You say, what does that mean? What is faith? Well, the Bible tells us, Hebrews chapter number 11, verse number 1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. You say, what's a substance? A substance, I believe, is something that you can take hold of. It's something you can grasp. And I believe God has given us a substance. Everything God wants us to know about himself, he has written it in the form of 66 books. He has given us everything. everything he wants us to know, and he's letting us hold it in our hands. We can read it. We can understand life's manual. We can know that God, how he wants us to live, how he wants us to die, how he wants us to worship, how he wants us to be saved. It's right here in the substance. Our faith comes from the Word of God. Now, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. We have a substance that God has given us. We have faith right here in our hands. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. You say that word hope, we use it all the time. I hope I win the lottery. I hope this. I hope in the hospital. I hope they make it out of the... That's not the term that we're looking at right here in Hebrews chapter number 11. That word hope, it means steadfast, secure. Noah, looking through the portals of time, he said, my hope is not in Mr. Noah. My hope is not in the name Noah. My hope is not in what Noah can do, what Noah will do, what Noah's gonna do. He said, but my hope is in God Almighty. My hope is in the blessed Savior, Jesus Christ. We have hope in our faith that we get from the Word of God. We have hope that God will do exactly what God said he'd do. Our hope is in Jesus Christ. The Bible says, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. We have a hope that God will do exactly what he says he'll do. And Noah said, I've just got to believe God. I've got to take God at his word. Can you imagine, Brother Jason? The Bible says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God, of things not seen as yet. Can you imagine him going out and preaching? He goes down to what Dr. Schofield gives us the date, B.C. 2353, Genesis chapter number 6. Can you imagine Mr. Noah going to the B.C. 2353 Walmart? And he starts preaching to a group of men, maybe sitting there on the bench, maybe the people as they're coming out, and he says, I've got a word from God. There's going to be rain. And they scratch their head and they say, Noah, just one question. What's rain? And Noah scratches his head and you say, you know, I'm really not sure. But God has said there's going to be 40 days and 40 nights of rain, and I just have to believe God. And God said there's going to be a flood. And they scratch their head and say, another question, Mr. Noah, what's a flood? And Noah said, you know, I'm really not sure. We've not seen that. We've not seen a flood. But I believe God said there's going to be rain. There's going to be flood. And then Noah would say, and there's going to be judgment. And they'd say, Noah, what's judgment? We don't know what judgment is. And Noah would say, you know, I'm really not sure what judgment is. But God has said there's going to be rain. There's going to be flood. There's going to be a judgment. And guess what? I just have to believe God. I have to believe God is who he said he was. And God will do exactly what he said he'll do.
Yes, sir.
And they laugh at old Noah and say, Noah, right. Sounds like a pretty good fairy tale. But we just don't believe it. And Noah said, well, you will one day.
That's right.
And we go through this life and we tell people there's a hell. We tell people that people die and go to a place where the fire's not quenched and the worm dieth not. And they laugh and they make fun and they scorn and they say, we just don't believe it. And we have to say, well, believe it or not, that doesn't take away from the fact that God said it. And we believe it, friend. It settles it that God said it. And God said there's a judgment to come. God said he wouldn't destroy the world again by water. But our judgment that we have to face if we die without him is a hell that burns with fire. And Noah said, whether y'all believe it or not, I'm here to tell you what God has told me. And God said there's a judgment coming.
Yes, sir.
God said there's a rain. God said there's a flood. But there is a way of escape. And it's in the boat I'm building. It's in the ark. Now, I personally believe the ark was big enough for anybody and everybody that would have chosen to make their way in. Anybody in that day could have walked in that ark and escaped the judgment. But nobody but Noah's house chose to. And Noah said, hey, if I'm going to save my house, I just got to believe God. Whether the people believe it or not, I've got to tell what God said, and I've got to believe God. 25 years has passed. Noah's got 5-year-old boys right now, triplets probably. They're running around mama's feet. All they know is, son, go get me a piece of lumber over there. All they know is, son, go tell your mama to fix me some tea. I'm hot out here working on this boat. All they know is, daddy pegging up boards. All they know is, daddy putting on pitch. All they know is, daddy dedicating himself to building this ark. Right. Somebody comes along. Noah, we heard you preach 20 years ago that there was a judgment coming. We heard you preach 20 years ago there was a flood coming and rains are coming. And Noah, you've built in this monstrosity right here in your front yard. Noah, we could tell just by the way it's laid out how huge it's going to be. Noah, are you just trying to make a name for yourself? Are you just building a boat? Noah would take a peek over his shoulder, see his wife. Look back over the other shoulder and see his 3 little boys walk running around playing in the dirt. And Noah would say, you know, sir, I've been at this 25 years, but I'm not just building a boat. I'm not just trying to make a name for Noah, but I'm doing all I can to save my house. I'm doing all I can to save my family. He believed God. Number 2, how did Noah save his house? The Bible says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet. Now you listen to the next 3 words. Number 2, the Bible says that he moved with fear. I don't for one second believe that Noah was afraid of the upcoming judgment. I don't for one second believe he is afraid of the rain, the flood that was coming. You say, why? Because he had a promise from God. And that promise was, if you're in the boat when the judgment comes, you're going to make it through. You're going to make it if you're in the boat. I don't believe he was afraid of the wind, the lightning. I don't believe he was afraid of the seas that were going to be rolling and ripping. I don't believe he was afraid of the mockery that was going to come from his family, come from his friends. I don't believe he was afraid of what man could do. But this word fear, the Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes, a real good Bible definition for fear. It's fear God and keep his commandments. I believe the term fear here gives the connotation that Noah realized and recognized there was a God in heaven that was looking down on the affairs of men. And Noah realized that he was going to have to stand before this God of heaven one day. And Noah said, I have to move with fear, not afraid of the storm, not afraid of man, but I have to move with fear, realizing that there's a God keeping record of my actions, my reactions, my morals, my thoughts, my motives. God's keeping a record, and I have to move with fear, realizing that God in heaven is watching, and I'm going to have to give an answer for everything I've done in this body when I stand before him. I'm not going to have to stand and give an account as a dad and a husband for the Holly family. I'm not going to have to stand and give an account for the Gross family. I'm not going to have to stand and give an account for any other family in the building today. But I am going to have to stand for the 3 girls you saw standing right here, plus the 19-month-old, 20-month-old seating right back here. I am going to have to stand and give an account for the lady that was standing right here playing the bass. I am going to have to stand as a husband and a father. And I am going to have to give an account for every decision I've made, every action I've done, every reaction that's caused by an action. I am going to have to give an account for the Matthews family. So I, as a dad, I, as a husband, I need to move with fear, realizing that God is seated on high and he's looking down low and he's keeping record of everything that I'm doing every second of every day. I'm amazed, and you know me, I'm as Baptist from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. I've been Baptist 9 months before I was ever born. But I'm amazed at how many Baptists, when the last amen is said on Sunday nights, that they think God takes vacation. They think God turns a blind eye and a deaf ear to the sins they're going to commit on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday. But friend, I got news for you. God's watching all the time. We put our church go to meet and come close on the next Sunday, and then we think God turns back around and He gives us a check mark and a gold star by our name because we made it to church on Sunday. Friend, God's watching what you do on Monday. He's listening to what you say. He's reading your very thoughts. God knows, and God's keeping record.
Yes, sir. Amen.
And we as parents, we as husbands, we need to move with fear, realizing that we're going to have to stand before Him, those eyes of fire, as Revelation says. And we're going to have to give an account for the whys and the why nots as to how we lived this life, the decisions we made concerning our family, the decisions we've made when we're by ourselves. The character, whether we chose to keep it when nobody else was looking. But God's keeping record. And God sees what you do behind closed doors, sir. He knows what you're looking at on the internet. Ma'am, He knows what you're watching on your phone. He knows the thoughts you're thinking. And we're going to have to move with fear, realizing that it's appointed unto man once to die. And after this, the judgment. You say, I'm saved. It won't be that bad. I'm afraid it will be that bad. We're going to have to give an answer as to why we did this or why we didn't do that. We will. If we lead our kids down the wrong way, we will have to answer for it. And Noah said, if I want my wife and my three boys in that boat when the judgment comes, I'm going to have to move with fear, realizing that God's keeping record. 50 years has passed. Noah's got 30-year-old boys. Maybe these boys have become men and taken themselves wives. Somebody comes along. Noah might be up on a ladder. Maybe he's up on the very top. I don't know how far along. Maybe the boys is out gathering some hay to feed the animals. Maybe they're out raising some onions and taters and peas for them to eat. I don't have a clue. All these boys have known is working on this ark. All these boys have known is their daddy going off and preaching and telling everybody that there's a judgment coming. And somebody comes along and says, Noah, you've been at this a long time. You've been building this boat 50 years. Look at the size of this thing. Just to sit right here in your front yard and make a museum, make a historical site. Noah, are you just building a boat?
Yeah.
And Noah would look at his wife. Look at them three boys, maybe holding the hands of their wives.
Yeah.
And Noah would say, no, sir. After 50 years, I'm still not building a boat.
Oh, yeah.
But I'm doing all I can to save my house.
Yeah.
I'm doing all I can to save my family. Number three, Noah believed God and moved with fear. The Bible says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear. Listen to the next three words. Number three, the Bible says he prepared an ark. Nowhere in Scripture will you find when God comes to Noah, Genesis chapter number 6, verse number 14 tells him to make thee an ark. Nowhere in Scripture will you find that God dumped a truckload of money at Noah's feet and said, here's everything you're going to need to build that boat. You won't find it. I know God provided where God leads. God does provide. It's proven throughout the whole Bible. Where God leads, He will provide. But Noah didn't have a Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you.
Yeah.
Noah didn't have a Philippians 4:19. But my God shall supply all your needs according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Noah didn't have a Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good.
Yeah.
Noah didn't have the promises of the New Testament like we have today. But I believe Noah, when God said, Noah, prepare an ark, I believe Noah thought the size of this thing, it's going to take me the rest of my life. I'm going to have to spend every dime I have to buy the material. I'm going to have to give labor. I'm going to have to give effort. But I believe Noah looked to take a little peek over his shoulder, saw his wife. Saw them three boys. And Noah said, you know, it doesn't matter how much I have to spend. It doesn't matter how long it takes me. They're worth it.
Right.
My family is worth it. Mamas and daddies, it might take an extra hour getting up on Sunday mornings to get them boys ready for Sunday school. It might take a few dollars worth of extra gas to go by and pick up a neighbor's kid so you can bring them to the house of God and they can get into Sunday school. They can get under the preaching. It might cost a few extra dollars to take them kids to summer camp where they can hear about Jesus Christ. But I promise you, mamas and daddies, it'll be worth every dime you invest. If it's your little boy that walks down an aisle, if it's your little girl that gives their heart to Jesus Christ, it'll be worth every time you've ever spent. It'll be worth every dollar you've ever given. Noah said, God has given me a job to do, and I've got to prepare an ark. It doesn't matter the cost. It doesn't matter the time. I've got a job to do.
Amen.
We complain about the cost of gas. Oh, we got to fill up the bus again. But I promise you, I've never one time in my life seen a U-Haul being pulled by a hearse.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Two old fellas standing on the golf course talking. The funeral procession of a rich man goes by. One of the men asked the other man, I wonder how much he left behind. The other man said he left it all. He left it all. You won't take the gold and the silver, the 401ks, the nice houses, and there's nothing wrong with that. I want it by far, Brother Jason, for my kids to have it far better than I ever did. But if I let them concentrate more on the blessing than they concentrate on the blesser, they'll miss heaven. They'll have it in their head, but they won't have it in their heart. If you tell them that it's all about the gold, if you tell them that it's all about the savings, then they'll grow up and they'll be miserable because they'll be lost. They may be rich, but they'll be lost and on their way to hell.
Amen.
We don't do what we do just to do what we do. Noah said, God's given me a job to prepare the ark. I'm not just preparing an ark, just to prepare an ark. But Jason, we don't preach just to preach. And Steve, you don't go out and sing just to go out and sing. Why do we do what we do? It's to save our house. If you're a deacon, you deek because it's what you do. It's because God has given you a job. If you're an usher, if you sing in the choir, we don't do it just to have something to do. But we want to do all we can for the glory of God. We want to show our kids that God's alive and that God's well and that God still saves old sinners. Noah said, I've got to build a boat. If it costs me every dime, if it costs me my life, I've got to prepare an ark. Mamas and daddies, what are you lifting up in front of your kids? What are you showing them that's important? Is it God? Noah said, I want my boys to miss the judgment. I want my wife to miss the judgment. So I've got to do what God's told me to do. I've got to prepare an ark. I've got to do it. That is the job, the 9-to-5. Why do you do what you do? Is it to make the almighty dollar? Why do we do what we do, mamas and daddies? I believe everything we do ought to give glory and honor to God. And everything we do ought to have purpose, showing these little ones right here that we're here not just to save our own house, but we're trying to save your house. Little boy, we want your mom and daddy in church. Little boy, we want your mom and daddy here. We want your sisters here. We want your brothers here. We're doing all we can, not just standing up here hollering in your face and spitting out. We want you to know that God will save you if you'll trust in Him. We want you to know that God will save your mama, and God will save your daddy, and God will save your whole house if they'll trust in Him. Noah said, if it costs me every dime, if it takes me the rest of my life, if I have to give and give and give, I can take one thing in this life to heaven with me. I can take my family. Noah believed God. He moved with fear. He prepared an ark. Number four, 75, 80 years has passed. Noah's got 60 or 65-year-old boys. All these boys have known Brother Jason is hauling wood, cutting boards, measuring, climbing ladders. I mean, that's all they know. Somebody comes along. Noah, look at the size of this thing, man. My goodness. Are you just building a boat? Noah would look at his wife. Look at them boys. Look at them daughter-in-laws. And Noah would say, you know, I'm not just building a boat. I'm doing all I can to save my house. Number four, and this is the hardest for Baptists. The Bible says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. By the which, and listen to the next three words, condemned the world.
Go ahead, preacher.
If you read chapter number 5, read the lineage of Noah. And again, if my North Carolina public school education is correct, Noah's daddy lived 120 years into the building process of the ark. No, he lived 115 years into the building process of the ark. Noah's grandfather, you know him by the name of Methuselah, the oldest man to ever live. Methuselah lived the whole 120 years in building the ark. History would have us to believe that Methuselah died right before the floods came. The Bible says that Lamech, Noah's dad, after the birth of Noah, lived so many years, begat sons and daughters, and he lived 700 and some odd years, and he died. No doubt Noah's dad was living, his granddad was living, his brothers and sisters were probably still alive. His wife had a mom and dad, probably brothers and sisters that were still alive. His daughter-in-laws had brothers and sisters, moms and dads, maybe grandmas and grandpas that were still alive. But the Bible doesn't record that anybody in Noah's family helped him build that ark. So I believe we can safely assume that the Bible talks about the whole earth being corrupt. I believe we can be safe in assuming that Noah's family, apart from his wife, his three boys, and his three daughter-in-laws, we can assume that the rest of his family was out there living in sin. Yeah. Doing what everybody else was doing. Maybe one day Noah's working. Maybe it's a hot August afternoon. Noah's working. Maybe Noah's sister, maybe Noah's brother comes to him. Noah's up on a ladder. She calls him down, says, "Brother Noah, come down. I got some news. We're having a family reunion down by the river this coming weekend. 2 or 3 days of drinking and carrying on and drugs and everything else that may go on. All the corruptness that the earth is doing. Noah, why don't you show them boys what living is? Why don't you bring them down, take a break for just a couple of days. Come down here and enjoy life. Give up this nonsense. Give up this notion of just working on this boat, just building this boat. Come on down and enjoy yourself for just a couple of days." That word condemned, he condemned the world. That word gives the connotation that Noah had to pronounce damnation on the world. And I believe myself that Noah's response to his sister, to his brother, probably was, "You know, you're welcome to come in here and join me.
Yes, sir.
Amen. You're welcome to come in here and take a seat on the ark when it's done, miss the judgment, but I can't come out there and join you."
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
I have to say no to what you're doing. I have to condemn what you're doing.
Amen.
Noah literally had to turn his back on everything that was going out there.
You're right.
And concentrate on the task that was at hand. Now, I can imagine them boys, because I have daughters that are the same way. They bat their eyes and they ask the same question, "Brother Jason, Daddy, why can't we? Why can't we do this? Why can't we go there? Why can't we go hang?" I can imagine them boys, "Daddy, we ain't seen our cousins in years. We don't know. All we know is building this boat. Oh, Daddy, why can't we go down there and enjoy ourselves for just a couple of days?"
That's good.
Go
And Noah could have used the connotation that we as dads use with our kids because daddy said so. But Noah went one step farther, Brother Jason. He said, son, we can't go because God said so. You say, what do you mean? God's pronounced judgment on them people 120 years. If they're not in the boat, they're going to die. Son, we can't go out there. And mamas and daddies, this world is no friend to your child. This world is no friend to your son. This world. And all it takes is you giving in one time. You saying, well, maybe just one time. All it takes is one joint. All it takes is one beer. And they may never make it back to the boat. They may never make it back to the ark. All it takes is you giving in, letting them hang out with the wrong crowd. All it takes is once, and they may never make it back.
Right.
Drug overdoses. Moms have said it was his first time. Head-on collisions. Alcohol's involved. Moms and dads say it was their first time. Moms and daddies, that's all it takes. One time, and they may never make it back. Them boys probably walked away kicking the dirt, talking amongst themselves. Daddy never lets us do anything. We never get to have any fun. Yeah. That old fuddy-duddy, he never lets us get to enjoy ourselves. All we know is building. But mamas and daddies, we need to condemn what's going on out there.
Amen.
We have to love the sinner. But we have to hate the sin.
Amen.
We have to say no. We can't take part what's going on out there.
Amen.
You can come in here and join us, but we can't take part what's going on. You're welcome to come in here.
Amen.
You're welcome to do what we're doing, but we have to pronounce damnation. We have to say no. We have to condemn what's going on out there.
Yes, sir.
Noah turned his back on everybody else in his family. I believe he gave him the invitation. You're welcome to come in here.
Yeah.
But I can't go out there.
Yes,
Noah, why? I'm doing all I can to save my house.
Yes, sir.
I'm doing every bit of my power. I'm giving everything I have to save my house.
Amen.
Brother Jason, 115 years has passed. Everybody in five states has heard.
Yeah.
Everybody in the world probably after 115 years has heard that Noah's building a boat. Noah, we heard you preaching a few years ago. We just had to make the journey after 115 years. See for ourselves. Man, look at this thing. Man, look at the size. Noah, he may be up on the top, maybe framing out the window. He may be putting the last little bit of corn and taters and maters and peas and hay in that boat. He may be waiting on the snail to come in. And this fella looks up and hollers, Noah, where are you, Noah? Are you just building a boat? Noah would look at his wife. Same old story, 115 years. He'd look at his wife. Look at them three boys. Look at them three daughter-in-laws. Come down the levels of that ark, walk out the door, look at this fellow in his eye and say, you know, I heard you hollering up at the top of the boat. I'm not just up there building a boat, but I'm doing all I can to save my house.
Amen. Praise God. That's
good. How'd he save his house? He believed God, moved with fear, prepared an ark, condemned the world. Number five, the Bible says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. By the which he condemned the world, and you listen to the next line. Number five, he became heir to the righteousness, which is by faith.
That's right.
That word heir, an interesting word. The dictionary would tell us that that word heir means a son or daughter in the family is entitled to everything that daddy has. The Bible tells us that we're heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Everything that Jesus Christ owns, guess what? We get to take part in it. It belongs to us. Everything that God owns belongs to Christ. And everything that Christ owns, guess what? We get to be joint heirs with Him. We get to be partakers of the heavenlies. We get to be partakers of everything that our Father owns. But how do we do it? You say, we have to become heirs to what? The righteousness. Not anything good that we've done. Not on a name that's in ourselves. Not on righteousness that we manufacture, but righteousness of the only begotten Son of God. Righteousness of Jesus Christ. You say, what does that mean? You can name it anything you want to. Saved, redeemed, pardoned, born again, being washed in the blood, being washed, being saved by amazing grace. You can call it whatever you want to, but it's being a child of God and knowing that Jesus Christ knows you as His child. I think about the prodigal. I want my family to come. Get ready to sing an invitation. I think about that prodigal. The Bible says he went to Dad and said, Dad, give me my portion. Dad gave him his portion. He went out just a few days. The Bible says that he wasted everything. Wasted his substance. Michaela, come on. Madison, come on. He wasted his substance, Brother Jason. Wound up in a hog pen with probably a bucket of slop. And the Bible says that he would have filled himself with the husk of the swine, but he came to himself. And he rehearsed the story. He didn't think about Dad. He didn't think about everything that God has, but he got to thinking about the servants in Daddy's house. And he said, you know, my servants have provision. They have food. They have a roof over their head. They have good food to eat. And I'm stuck out here in the hog pen. Brother Jason, the Bible says that he came to himself. I believe he dropped the pail and hit the trail. Rehearsed that story all the way to the house. He said, Daddy, I've sinned against you. I've sinned against heaven. I'm no longer to be called your son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. I bet he rehearsed that story all the way to the house. The Bible says that the father saw him a great way off and ran. In Jewish days, rich men didn't run. That was an abomination. That was embarrassment if a man with wealth ran. But I believe this daddy said, you know, my boy's coming down the road. My boy's coming back home. And the Bible says that when he put his foot on his neck, he was supposed to fall on him with his foot on his neck. And the boy was supposed to die right there for being an embarrassment to the family. But he didn't fall on his neck with judgment. He fell on his neck with compassion. The Bible says he kissed him. And I believe he kissed him right smack dab on the lips, because that's where kisses go. And I believe the boy started in, Daddy, I've sinned against you. I've sinned against heaven. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me one of your hired. And I believe the daddy put his hand on his mouth and said, son, we won't have that kind of talk around here. He hollers out to the servants. He said, go get my robe. Go get my shoes. Go get a ring. Let's kill the fatted calf because my son has come home. That boy was covered with the filth of this world. He couldn't get into daddy's house. Covered in the filth of the world. Daddy said, so I'm going to put my robe on you. I'm going to cover you with my righteousness. If you got my righteousness on, you're able to get in the house. He said, boy, your feet, they're dirty. They've been walking places they shouldn't have walked, but you're going to cover up them feet. You're going to put my shoes on. You're going to put my righteousness on your feet. And that ring doesn't tell me that you're a servant. That ring tells me that you're a son. And he said, you have access to the kingdom. Why? Because you're going in my righteousness. You're going in with my ring. You're going in as part of the family. You can go on into daddy's house because you're covered in the righteousness of the Father. That's the only way you'll make it to heaven. You've been trodden this earth. You're covered with filth. We're born sinners. And we have to have a way out. And that way, Brother Jason, is the righteousness. And I believe Noah thought, my wife's going to have to choose to go in that boat. I can't make her. My boys are going to have to choose. So I, as a dad, I'm going to have to show them what it is to be an heir of grace.
Amen.
Of righteousness. 119 years, 364 days, 23 hours, and 55 minutes has passed. The judgment's coming. The door's already shut. Brother Jason Noah's sitting on the seat. He got his wife by the hand. One last heckler comes by. The door's shut. He hollers, "Noah! Noah! Man, this sure is a big old monstrosity, Noah. Are you just building a boat, Noah? What are you doing? Are you trying to make a name for yourself?" As the rain starts to fall on that man's head. And that man looks up. Oh no. With a tear coming down Noah's face, I believe Noah whispers, "As the floods give up the deep," he can't see a thing, but I believe he can hear every scream of every person that's coming by. And I believe with tears going down his face, Brother Gary, I believe Noah whispers under his breath, "I tried to tell you, I wasn't just building a boat. I was doing all I can."
Amen.
As he grabs his wife by the hand, "I was doing all I can to save my house." The boat starts to reeling and a rocking. That big old monstrosity of a ship starts to reeling and a rocking. Them boys make their way over to Daddy with tears going down their face. And they said, "Daddy, we couldn't understand. We couldn't understand why you wouldn't let us go do this, and why we couldn't partake of that, why we couldn't go here, why we couldn't go see this." With tears coming down their face, Brother Jason, I believe them boys, every one of them whispered in Daddy's ear, "But Daddy, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for standing for God. Thank you for condemning the world. Thank you for having our best interest at heart, Daddy." Friend, I want you to know, if we say no to our kids and they make it into heaven, it won't be because we were good parents, but it's because there's a great God in heaven who had mercy. But we as parents need to do everything we can to show them that there's righteousness, that there is love, there is a God in heaven. They won't make it in on your coattails. They'll have to choose to become an heir to the righteousness. History would have us to believe Noah was a failure. Preaching 120 years, Brother Brian, only 8 people in that boat. He should have been having a mega church. He should have been running thousands, Brother Jason. But I believe Moody said, "If I go out and win the whole world and lose my family," Moody said, "I'm a failure." Noah said, "My purpose, I want everybody to come in that wants to come in. But my purpose is seated right here on this ark with me. My purpose was my boys. My purpose was my daughter-in-laws. My purpose was my wife." And God writes Noah's name out. And by his name, he puts check. Success. Mamas and daddies, the question again, why do you do what you do? Are you just building a boat?
That's good. That's
good. Are you doing all you can to save your house? Noah said, "I've done all I can." They're going to follow you. They're going to do what you do. Are you believing God? Moving with fear? Preparing an ark? Condemning the world? Becoming an heir to the righteousness, which is by faith? It's up to you. The ball's in your court. Are we doing all we can to save our house? We're standing all over.
As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. The great thing is this, is that Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me." There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth Him shall not perish but have everlasting life." And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not a son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. That means that God sent his son to die for those of us who are sinners so that we can have fellowship with God himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that he tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? When I ask you, would you trust in him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from. God sent his son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.